come celebrate Christmas with us, to celebrate the birth of Jesus. We have our first Bible reading this morning, so Danielle, if you would come up and give that. We've been going through a period of time that's referred to as Advent, which has this meaning of like waiting. And Advent is this time where we realize we are waiting for Jesus to come and that we're waiting for Jesus to come again. So we have Bible readings spread throughout the service. We'll have some Christmas carols and light all four candles this week because this is the fourth week of Advent. So after the hour, we'll read and light all four candles and then we'll go further with our service. But Dana, if you would.
So hi everyone, I'm Dana. So we will begin today by reading Psalm 56 as we are encouraged to join with creation to sing and rejoice because of the Lord. Reigns and has come. Psalm 96. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise his name, proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nation, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. For great is the Lord and most worthy of his of praise. He is to be feared above all gods, for all gods of the nation are idols. But the Lord made the heaven. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and glory are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord all the families and of nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory to his name. Bring offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in his splendor of holiness. Tremble before him all the world. See among the nations the Lord reigns. The world is firmly established, it cannot be moved. He will judge the people with equity. Let the heaven rejoice, let the earth be glad, let the sea resound, and all that is in it. Let the fields be jumping, and everything in them. Let all the trees of the forest sing for joy. Let the creation rejoice before the Lord, for he comes, and he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness, and the people his faithfulness.
Yeah.
to greet someone around you, shake their hand or give them a hug, tell them that you're glad that they're here, tell them Merry Christmas, my friend. And we'll now have our second Bible reading.
Now let us read what the prophet Isaiah said of the hope of the child that will be born. The people walked in darkness. They have seen a great light. A light on those living in the land of deep darkness. A light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest. As warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The seal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Thank you.
third Bible reading taken from the Gospel. I'm going to read from Luke chapter 1, verse 26 till 38. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month, for no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your God to me be fulfilled." Then the angel left her. Amen. This is the word of God. Please feel free to stand with us as we sing a few more songs on the good news that the angel's birth.
Thank you. God, my Savior, for he has been mindful of the the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down rulers from their thrones, but has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, just as he promised our ancestors.
Thank you.
What can I give him?
Please feel free to have a seat. One of the things that we give God is our talents and our creativity. And we have some young ladies in the church who said, hey, we'd love to do a dance on Christmas as one way to show appreciation to the Lord and hopefully help people view more towards that. So give us a moment to kind of move some things out of the way. And ladies, if you would come.
He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome.
The true light that gives light to everyone was come into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children were not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the far, full of grace and truth.
So Merry Christmas. We're in the season of Advent. It's a season of hope. That just as people waited for the Messiah to come 2,000 years ago, now we wait for him to return. That we realize, yes, Jesus was born and lived, died, and rose from the dead, and he will come back. And we hope for that, and we wait for that. But just because we're waiting for him to return doesn't mean that he's not speaking to us. Doesn't mean that there's nothing going on. And so as a church, over the last few months, we've been going through a series that we called God is Calling, because we believe God continues to speak to us today, and seeing how he continues to call us to good work, and how he continues to interact with us. God is not far off in space, as though he's far away. He's not far off in time, like it was only 2,000 years ago. God has not forgotten or abandoned us. But in our everyday lives, in our everyday situations, God is still calling everyday people to be part of his kingdom and to be part of his work. So today, as we're looking towards the birth of Jesus, I want to talk about how God is calling children. Christmas is the celebration of how the one and only Son was sent by the Father, the Word taking on flesh and dwelling among us. A child is born, a son is given. So many of these things from the Bible readings we've had speak of a child, a son, a baby. God called Jesus into the earth first to be a baby. But I'll go even further back in the story. In the Bible, at the beginning, in the book of Genesis, when God created humanity, we're told that he made them after his own image. The first sentences about what humans were to be is that we were made in his image, male and female. God created them. And that doesn't, for many people, automatically say, oh, that's a parent and a child. But if you think about it, right, made in his likeness. A few chapters later, in Genesis 5, it repeats this thing that God made humanity in his image. And then talks of this man, Adam, that said Adam had a son in his own image, in his own likeness, whose name was Seth. And so, like, right next to each other, we're told that, like, the whole being in God's image was being his child. For those of you who didn't know, the two children that just spoke, giving the Bible reading from John, if you had to guess whose image and likeness they are made in, you can look at me. Because those are both my sons, right? There's strong family resemblance. That's part of this idea of likeness and image, is that we're children. God's first creation of humanity is that we were to be his children. But something happened in the middle where, though we never lost, humanity didn't lose this sort of status of being children of God, but we stopped kind of reaching the standard of what that was to be a child of God. Someone gave an example sort of like this. Here's a guitar. It is a Taylor brand guitar. Taylor is a pretty good quality guitar. So it has that status of a Taylor guitar. No matter what happens to it, it was still made as a Taylor guitar. You can paint on it, you can draw on it, you can choose to use it for a candle, you can use it as a plate over at McDonald's and eat off of it. You can do what you want to it. That doesn't change the status that it's a Taylor guitar. Well, like if you snap the neck of it, it won't make the sound that it was created to make, and so it won't live up to sort of the standard of what these guitars are supposed to be because it wasn't used correctly. So part of what we see at Christmas is that Jesus comes back to remind us and set the standard of what it means to be a child of God. He was the one who came to live at that standard. So the angel Gabriel showed up to Mary, as we heard. The angel said that he will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The power of God, the power of the Most High will overshadow you, so the baby to be born will be holy and will be called the Son of God. This idea of the Jesus, who we know, almost the first thing that we know about Jesus is that he's to be a son, to be a child. I somewhat wonder if up in heaven, as God the Father and Jesus are speaking, and the angel Gabriel comes in and goes, okay, Gabriel, you are now going to go speak to Mary, and this is what you are to tell her, that Jesus will be born and he'll be a son of the Most High. And I would wonder if Jesus was sitting on the side, being like, can you throw in a few extra things to make it sound really good? Like, and he's going to be handsome, and he's going to be like the wisest person. He's going to be like really super strong. And God the Father is, he will be known as the Son of the Most High, the Son of God. Okay, well, if I'm going to be a baby, at least make it sound like it'll be nice to have a baby. So be like, the baby will be born on a silent night. Little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. No, he's a perfect baby. Ooh, that sounds like a good song. And I think the Heavenly Father said, no, just a baby. Jesus was a regular old baby. And sometimes, even though we get excited about babies, we sort of devalue what a baby can do, because a baby doesn't do much, right? If you've ever had a baby, it doesn't come out crawling or speaking or doing some of these things. And thus, of course, you're like mythological babies from gods, where it's like half god, half human, but like in Greek mythology, this one just like jumps out of the head of its dad, fully grown. If Christianity was going to try to come up with a myth that's false, they would have made Jesus this like full-grown baby that could do everything. But he wasn't. Jesus wasn't like those gods that was like half God, half man, that then was given like superpowers. That were then like, oh, no one else is like this baby. Because, I mean, this baby comes out and can already like lift up mountains and throw them into the sea. Jesus came out as just a normal baby. And the interesting thing was, though Jesus was unique, the one and only Son, there's this title given to Jesus that there's something special about him. Even Jesus later, when he spoke about lifting up mountains and throwing them into seas, wasn't something for Hercules to do. It was something that his regular old students, who by faith live that way. So Jesus came as a regular baby that had to live through being a baby. I don't know if Mary thought the terrible twos was a thing with Jesus, but he went through being an infant, being a toddler, learning how to walk. It wasn't like Jesus was born and then, okay, 30 minutes later, he's 12 years old. Give him like a day and he's an adult grown male. No, the first calling of Jesus was just to be a child. As humble and as simple as that is. There is a man named Paul who wrote about Jesus in Philippians chapter 2 that Jesus, though he was in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped and held on to, but instead he humbled himself and took the form of a servant, being found as a human. And that God chose to be found as this humble human is what we celebrate today. For as strange as that sounds, to celebrate it. As the angels proclaimed, the glory to God in the highest, God showed up in the lowest. Just a baby, not born in a fancy palace, but born in a small town. Commonplace with an earthly job, with the earthly dad that was sort of going to help raise him, have just a regular job. All seemed kind of normal. And that's part of why it surprises me so much when people try to say, oh, Jesus was like all of these just retellings of other ancient myths. The Egyptian god Horus, or some like demigod from Greece. All of those stories were made to make those gods so separate from everyone that like you'd never be able to approach that. But instead, Jesus was truly different. He came as fully God, yet fully human. And Jesus displayed that strength of God, and yet the weakness of a human. He displayed the authority of God and yet the servanthood of what it means to be human. He displayed the eventual maturity of being a full-grown adult, but also at the beginning he lived through just regular old childhood. I wonder what that would have been like for Jesus to be asked by the Father. This calling, go be a baby. And Jesus could do so many things. It's like, I got skills, as you know, like one part of the Trinity. Yeah, I just need you to be a baby right now. To be childlike. So as we come to the manger, realize that for that moment at least, Jesus was fulfilling his calling by being nothing more than a child. And as humans, we like to rush the story. Pastors really like to rush the story. And Christmas is like, Jesus was born and he's automatically dying on the cross. And like, we skip out a lot of this growing phase. But God didn't rush the story. God let Jesus grow and take time. But for a very specific purpose. Jesus was sent as the Son of God. In what we're told in John chapter 1, that from all who would receive him, to those who would believe in his name, he would give them the right to become children of God. He became a child so that we can be a child. So if Jesus came as a child, will you do that? Jesus, when he was an adult, was having a conversation with this old man who had been sort of seen as a leader in the community. His name was Nicodemus. And Jesus said, you have to be born again. And this old man had what seems like an obvious question, how's that gonna work? I'm old. I came out of my mom one time, and that's not something that you can undo. Right? Baby comes out, you can't return the baby inside the mother and have it come out again. That's not how that works. And Jesus tells Nicodemus to come and live as a child in the same way that Jesus did. Not in your own strength or effort, but he says, those who are born of his spirit. We heard it's called sometimes the Annunciation, when Gabriel showed up to Mary and said, you're going to have this baby, and he said, the Holy Spirit will overshadow you, and you will have a child. Jesus was born through the word of the Holy Spirit. And then Jesus tells Nicodemus, if you want to be born again, that's going to come about through this miraculous work of the Holy Spirit. Question is, will we be humble enough to accept it? Humble like Mary. When Gabriel spoke to Mary and said, you have been chosen, highly favored woman, her response was that she was God's servant girl. She would do what God asked. And she found that God exalts the humble. We heard that reading from later in chapter 1, where Mary is making this song, and so much of it is about God exalts the humble. Will we come and be humble at Christmas, like Mary was, like Jesus was, who humbled himself, and therefore God has given him the name that is above every other name for his humble. Humility is where we start. And humility includes praising God for what he's done. So as I said, sometimes we rush the story a lot further along. Jesus, 33 years later, after his birth, as he was sort of entering the temple, as he was walking among his own, but so many of his own didn't recognize who he was. So many of the religious leaders didn't realize he was that Messiah. But the ones who seemed to get it were little kids. As Jesus was sort of entering the city, there's this huge celebration, and kids are cheering, and these religious leaders, they go up to Jesus, and they said, teacher, don't you realize what's going on? These kids are getting out of hand. That's not how it's supposed to go. And Jesus' response is, well, haven't you read the scriptures? Because those say that you have taught children and infants to give you praise. Part of the reason we're called to come like a child is because children can be glad to celebrate almost anything. You tell them it's a celebration, they're on board. They're willing to humble themselves enough to get excited and to praise. And as adults, sometimes we take a while to be convinced of something. But my hope for you today is that when you come to Jesus, consider what are these things that we've read that God promised to come and live among us. That instead of waiting to try to be convinced, that also like a child, you will humbly accept and rejoice and celebrate. That you'll be like the children and infants who give praise to God because of the things that he's done. It's part of what God is doing is calling children. He's calling each one of us, giving us the right to be children of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving us in such a way that you would send Jesus to be a baby. That you would take your most precious relationship things that you promised. Thank you, Lord, for taking your time. Thank you for sending Jesus to show us that humility and also to express that joy as we see through Jesus' life and the joy that he had. May we be children like that too, humble and joyful. In Jesus' name, amen. The story didn't stop with Jesus being born. But after he was born, the news had to be spread. Right? Just like children like to tell you everything that's going on in their lives, or at least mine does. My youngest son, he'll go to anyone and tell them, hey, you know what just happened? And they'll tell you. Even if you're the one who taught him something, he'll come up and tell you, like, you know what I just learned? I'm like, yes, I just taught you. But he had to get it out. And that's something that we see in the shepherds. So we have our last Bible reading of this morning, taken from Luke chapter 2. If we could come forward and read it. We'll have our last Bible reading of the response of these shepherds who were told that Jesus was born by the angels, that the Messiah had come, and what they would do afterwards. So, Beek, if you would please come forward, we'll have that, and then we'll sing a few more songs before our announcements. Before we...
So the shepherds heard of the word of the Messiah from the angels. Let us read the response in Luke chapter 2, verses 15 to 20. When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, let's go to Bethlehem and see the thing that happened, which the Lord has told us about. So they hurried up and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was laying in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
So feel free to stand with us as we respond in the same way the shepherds did. I want you to go out and tell others this good news.
Oh! Thank you.
joy of the Holy Spirit living inside, with the love of the Heavenly Father, the wonders of His incredible love to know us and to send His Son for us. And may you go in the hope that Jesus Christ has come and that Jesus will come again. May you go in peace and have a blessed Christmas period.